Boy, you're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
Indeed, welcome to the barbershop, courtesy of Hatchy, the mouthpiece.
That's a great intro. I'm glad he did that.
Yeah, I'm glad we stole it, too. We didn't ask him permission. That's the Hamilton way. We call that in Hamilton. If you want to build an apartment or a corner store and you own a piece of land that has anything on it, you burn it. That's called a Hamilton building permit. And you can start construction the next day. And we kind of took that thing because Hashi is a native son and a motherfucker. Man, that guy can beatbox. He is quick and fast. Did that little impromptu jam on his episode that you can see on barbershoppodcast.com. We stole it, put it on the beginning of the Barbershop Podcast theme song, King of Rock and Roll, which is not available anywhere. I think it's time that we should get that up on iTunes, and that's where you can support this damn show. Put that for your ringtone. Or you know what I was thinking? Put the lyrics up. It's a pretty simple song. And we'll take submissions from different bands doing King of Rock and Roll, their own version. And we'll put it together. We'll even record it here at Boxo Studio.
What do they win?
Yeah. What do they win? Well, that's going to be up to the other people in marketing. And, that's me. All right. We'll figure that out. These are just ideas popping. This is what happens. Barbershop Podcast from Boxo Studio. The shadow of the Hamilton Mountain, Hamilton, Ontario, the blast furnace of original music and musicians, real people, legitimate, something that maybe you wouldn't have gotten an opportunity to hear or see. It's on the internet forever now, baby. Ryan Cannon, Gary Greenland, as always, wonderful having you in. How are things going?
Good. Another week with no dental work, but I'm getting some next week. So.
Are you?
Yeah.
And you got it. You were droning this week. You got like Ryan. Ryan is like totally into it. It's so great because he loves the drones, right? So he's like, oh, I got a new thing of this and that. And then it's like, oh, like this is something that's from like Independence Day, right? And then invariably he crashes it and it gets destroyed. But he gets a better version that is more capable and expensive that he destroys, right? So it's been a great week in Droneville, hasn't it?
Awful.
You can see it on YouTube if he shares.
It's private. I'm not ready yet.
No, but we are ready, and it is totally listed. Barbershop Podcast, three words, Barbershop Podcast on YouTube, up over 65,275 views as of this week. It is piling up. It is called The Tipping Point, Ryan Cannon. You know, 10% of the people get what you do right away. 10% of the people will never get what you do. The rest of it is a struggle pushing against the wall of resistance until you reach 50.00001% and whoosh, shit happens. It's happening here, Barbershop Podcast. Every week, you're going to find someone who is an original, is unique, and has a story to tell, who has dedicated their life to the art and the craft of music. They are people, and we answer the great questions of who are you and why do I care? It's a big struggle out there to be noticed, and Barbershop Podcast is the gold vein in the rock where you can look and know you're going to cash in. Boy, I'm on fire tonight, aren't I, Ryan Cannon?
You are on fire.
Jay Pollmann. Guy I met through. Oh yeah, and by the way, I want to talk about what I'm wearing. You know, it's like I'm full on wife beater tonight. And we talk about, I've been pretty honest. If you look at the episodes, shameless aversion and whatnot. I'm a big booster in music, certainly not for the fame and the glory and the fortune, but for the holistic, naturopathic qualities of music. It keeps me sane, gives me a reason for living. Yeah. And the jacket is a euphemism. I was up talking to Ginger St. James, and she's a great friend, and we were talking about shit. And she said, it must be hard to put the jacket on every week. And I go, well, there's certainly weeks that are easier than the others, and I can look back and remember, like, traumatic events that happened that week. And it's amazing when something so awful happened that week over almost a three-year period that you managed to pull your shit together on a Wednesday. And people thank me and say, thank you for what you do for the Hamilton and surrounding area music community. And I say, no, thank you. every Wednesday. Someone comes in here with a story of redemption, a story of perseverance, the very embodiment of their soul and why they do something altruistically and beautifully. And I don't care if you're this big or this big. There's something magical about music. You've got a story. We've been friends on social media for a while, but I don't know a whole lot about you. So let's start, as we normally do, and talk about music and your early influence. What were the first kind of burning memories or thoughts about how music entered your life?
Music was in the house. I think a lot of musicians say that. My dad played in bands, and I watched him play. I fell asleep to the band, jamming in the basement to the 80s rock tunes that they did, and I think it sunk in my head, and that's where part of it came from anyways. And Of course, you want to play. There's guitars in the house. Yeah. You're going to play them.
Yeah, because there was a generation, and they've been saying it for years, where music became less of the rationale behind why a kid would want to be a musician. Mm-hmm. Kind of dissipated. But you were thick in it because you also had your father's direct influence, and like every son wants to be like his dad or wants to please his dad, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So what were some of the tunes that stuck in your head early? What kind of, like, was there one of the, you know, I'm sure your dad, if he played a bunch of different styles, did a bunch of different tunes. What was the kind of stuff? Because like you're playing kind of it's hard to, you know, Americana, rootsy, blues, it's a general term. Mm-hmm. But when you were early, what really rocked you? What was the thing that you really liked?
Really rocked me. I don't know. I was small when I used to go down, and they got my dad and the band used to play Wipeout.
Yeah.
They had me down to the opening.
They'll do it every time.
And that was my bit, and I went right back upstairs and back into bed and listened to the rest of the night. So, you know, things like that sticking, and their parents took us to a lot of music festivals and things like that. And I don't know. This wasn't ever like a this moment, you know how people talk about this moment, that exact moment?
Right.
I think it's building and it's still there.
The sheer normalcy, right? For so many kids, you had to make an exception. You had to prove that this was somehow worthy to someone who has shut that art form out as a legitimacy. Yeah, but this is what you're saying, is you were infused with that every day, that absolutely a love of the arts and a love of music is legitimate, and I want my kid to have that.
Yeah, I'm still doing that.
Excellent.
Yes.
Parents, take note. You want interesting, soulful children, expose them to the arts.
To the arts, absolutely.
For sure. Now let's talk about when you start picking up an instrument. What was it? When was it?
I sang first, and I played in a band with my cousins, and we did covers. I was probably 12 years old or so, and I sang for a couple years before my fingers. I was a small kid before I could actually play a guitar, and it hurt like hell for a long time to play the thing. And my dad and I finished up an old Kent guitar and did the pinstriping all over it. You know, I still have the guitar. It's a badass.
So you better play thing. That. You better play that thing, right? After it's a father-son project. You're I'm not into it.
I should pull it out one of these days, you know, throw it on for a show. And then guitar developed, and then guitar was cool. Yeah. And you know, the kids in school, like, this guy plays guitar, so does this guy.
So, and it's next a great way to meet common buddies who have this share same passion, right?
That's when buddies kind of switch from, you know, the sports buddies or something.
I remember, and then 15, the 16. Arts buddies.
And I was actually thinking about that the other day, how much that has changed. Yeah. It's not like
it was one or the other in the day.
Yeah, it's not like I dislike anybody that I used to play sports with and all that kind of stuff. It's just, it's changed so much. And a lot of my great friends are people I met at music festivals or have created art with.
I find that weird. And I put it down to a sociological bent that we all try to seek purpose and a skill and an acceptance and somewhere where we get that redemption. And something happens in the formative years where it is, and I don't want to say like a left brain, right brain, fight or flight sort of thing, but you become a jock or you become an artist. And years later, it's wonderful to find those people who are both, who aren't threatened by either community for one reason or another.
And understand why you maybe still want to, why do you still play shows? Like, you're, you know, I'm 31 years old. I'm sure there's some friends from high school, public school, who's like, why is he still playing shows and stuff like that? But, you know, the people who know me why I do it, and I know why I have to do it too. It's a part of what I am when I do.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And did you, were you comfortable writing and doing your own thing, or did you play in bands first a lot?
No, that's, to be honest, only recently am I becoming comfortable with songwriting. I think it's me forcing myself to play solo and be on my own. I was thrown right into that again to have to be like that. So, and I've talked to you know, many musicians that say it takes that long to, you know, perfect the art, so to say. Or last time I bumped into Fred Eaglesmith, he told me that. He said I was 31 or 32 when, you know, the songwriting bug clicked for me, and that's when I wrote good songs from there.
Do you search for a muse still, or is it just a work ethic thing?
No, I do. Music still hooks me. Like,
do you,
when
do you
I
put
hear
yourself in precarious positions so you have things to write about?
Not necessarily. I've been trying to dabble with writing stuff that isn't so personal and things like that, but I've also been trying to be more personal too and connect, because I know that's things that people can connect with.
Personal, universal.
Yeah, but a lot of things just kind of, the best ones just kind of come out and you don't know where they come from.
And sometimes you read them a year later and you're like, that's what it's about.
Yeah. Or somebody like you, like, so, you know, I'm reading the lyrics here and I think this, it's about this, and you're like, holy shit, it might be about that. I never thought about that.
And it's a great thing, because it's a subconscious. You're just looking for a pattern and a rhyme, and something back there was giving you great A-grade stuff. Speaking of which, we always kick off here at Barbershop Podcast with a live tune.
All right.
And you've come in with a great drummer yourself, and you've come out with a great guitar player yourself, and a singer. And I love a one-man show. What are you going to start off with tonight?
I'm going to do actually a newer one. I wrote it the week after I made my record in March, and the creative juices were still flowing, and I was on a high from that. So this song came out in a couple nights. I had a melody in my head during the day. I hashed it out one night. Songs are always different how I write them. This one was full song on guitar and melody, and then I had to fit some lyrics to it. So
sweet.
That happened very quickly, and that's what I ended up with.
All right. Well, we're going to hear it. What's it called?
Can't Unwrite a Wrong.
Can't Unwrite a Wrong. You're going to hear it right here, right now, live on the good old barbershoppodcast.com.
Hey, we'll pass it all again. I lost but all one friend, but I win them back again. You'll see. Things will be different this time, with a new reason to rhyme, 'cause years have changed me. Well, I'm not the confrontational kind, but I sure can tell a good lie. I said, hey, that's no way to be. I said, I burned that bridge for cross that river on the other side, you see. I said, hey, that's no way to be. I said, I burned that bridge for cross that river on the other side, you see. Again, can I make up another friend? That sounds like a loaded question. I've been crying all day long, like a Tom Petty song. Yeah, so don't you do me like that. I'm not the confrontational kind, but I sure can't tell, I sure can't tell a good lie. Burn that bridge, pull across that river on the other sad, you see. I said, hey, that's the way to be. I said, I burned that bridge and flew across that river on the other side, you see. On the other side, you see. On the other side, you see.
You can't right or wrong, Jay Pollmann on Barbershop Podcast. And don't get no better than that. Live, real, original music. We are serious about this here at Barbershop Podcast. That's what we do. 191 freaking weeks. No, I'm saying fucking weeks. I got to swear because, unfortunately, because nobody listens to anything without an explicit content warning these days. We have to be dangerous. Let's talk about that a little bit, okay? You've been in it long enough at 31. I like that. I really didn't get serious about my music till I was in my mid-30s. Great period to be hacking away. You're strong enough to still carry an axe and swing it. But you've been doing it long enough to kind of get experienced, realistic about the business. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about Barbershop Podcasts. Let's talk about new media. Let's talk about the internet. Let's talk about what your opportunities and chances were before that versus what exists today.
Yeah. I think, first of all, I remember being like 18 years old and starting to get very serious about playing music and trying to do something with it. And, you know, you get a little bit of momentum going in the idea of maybe making a little bit of money at it or something, and there's that push for the next 25 was like the cap where it's like, if it's not happening by then, it's
fuck it,
that's done, it's over, so let's go, right? But I mean, at the time you're so inexperienced trying to learn everything about the business and how things work, how to book your own shows, how to, you know,
and be fearless at the same time.
Yeah,
there's no time to think about and say, I don't know, let me get back to you. You have to be yes
act now, right? Yeah. And I think by the time I know for myself, when you get to this point, it's kind of weeded out the rest of them, and the strong survive or the stupid survive, whatever you want to say, right? I don't know if you asked me like when I was younger, right now where I'm at, if I'd be music wise, if I'd be happy with that, I'd probably say no. But me now, I'm saying yes because I like what I'm doing and I'm having a lot of fun still. That's important. You know?
And then carving out that degree of autonomy. If you're going to be an artist and you want it to be, I always looked at it realistically. I thought, you know, if I love to do something, I never want music to be like a fishing or a ski trip where it's like, I got to spend $2,000 to do what I love.
Yeah.
You know, if I can break even where it's like, I just went on tour and I spent $8,000 and I made $7,700.
Yeah,
that's all right.
For everybody else, it's insane.
Exactly. Why would you do it? But it's like, man, that's the thing that drives me.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about the drug. Serotonin, melatonin, music as a healing balm, music as something that is a life force. Still being able to be professional with your own career and yet saying that, you know, I have to do something that is deeper than skin deep.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel as you know, your career kind of goes along, any kind of debt to saying, you know, as a songwriter and a musician, I have to be the Keats and Shelley of my generation. I have to kind of impart wisdom. Or you said that you don't really write about your own personal situations. What do you write? Because we're big on songwriters here because it's all original music.
Yeah. Well, yes and no. I do write about personal experiences too. It's just not so obvious, I guess, like, because that drives me insane when I hear a song. It's,
no one reads your diary. I don't want to read your diary. Make it sound like my diary.
You know, the lines like, I'm hurting inside and stuff like that. I know you are, but find a different way to say that, please, because everybody has said that.
Yeah.
Keeping it fresh, I guess. So I do write from, you know, personal experience, but I also try to keep it a little bit fun and quirky, you know, a balance between that, because I find it's almost, I think a lot of songwriters would say too, it's easy to write a kind of like a sad song before something that's
That's why there's
a little
so
bit
many,
more inspiring.
So many more sad songs than happy songs. And when you hear a great happy song,
oh, it nails you.
Boy, how many times we've been in love and it's like, oh, I should write about this. Oh, it's gone. You know? It's about six.
I don't want to write now.
6 weeks max. All right, we're going to play something off of your... What are we going to play? Is it a treat? Is it a tasty treat?
It is a treat. I brought some new stuff for you guys.
New stuff, and it's great because that's a great thing about Barbershop Podcast. This is on the internet forever. So this is your first taste of something that, you know, as someone who works in a recording studio here, it's like working on a sculpture, right? Mm-hmm. Where it's like, okay, Jay, you got to make a sculpture of yourself. And you have to be realistic about it, but you're also going to make it look as beautiful as you can. And it's an arduous process, the tiniest little things. Talk about what kind of experience recording has been.
This was a very fun recording experience. I bounced around I've been ready to record for a while. And I talked to a lot of people and just kind of feeling out what was the right route to go as a, you know, kind of a debut solo record. I wanted it to kind of make a statement in a way. And not just put out, you know, necessarily a record just for my close friends and family.
I want it for $80, and I want it tomorrow. Because you can do that.
You can
right?
do that, and I did think about doing that. I looked into a few spaces and talked to some guys. We were gonna get some mobile gear and rent, you know, be on an old kind of stage, and there were in a barn. We talked about doing that too in a barn. And
so many options.
I'm glad I didn't go that route now, but that you know I might come back to that one day.
Yeah.
So I pitched the idea. Aaron Goldstein, who I've looked up to for years.
Lee Harvey Osmond,
local pedal steel legend. Yeah. And those two, he was producing some records out of Toronto, so I was like, shit, I'm just going to throw it out there. I'm just going to write him an email and see what he thinks. And we played shows, a few, back in the day in Hamilton at the, you know, the Pepper Jack Cafe, and way back in the day. And I sent him some demos, and a little bit to my surprise, he was really, 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 really stoked on them, and had some ideas for him immediately, and he's like, if you want to do this, let's do it.
Yeah.
I'm into it.
And were you cool with, like, releasing because he was kind of... And, again, there's a lot of great young producers who have to prove themselves.
Yeah.
And then there's a lot of producers who you already empathize with as an artist. It's tough to give up your baby, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's tough to give up creative control. Was it easy for you? Were you willing to once the money came out of your pocket? You're like, it doesn't serve me to fight this, or
it's,
what?
It's one of those things where you let the magic happen, and you hope it does.
Yeah.
And... You know, I was confident, like, because I know
most
things.
Would you recommend to an emerging artist to just, if you could afford a producer, let him be more than an engineer?
Yes, but the right one, too.
Yeah.
There's a lot of ones that I would not recommend, too, that I've heard or seen.
Yeah,
so.
And it's like dating.
That's a tough one.
You know
it
when you feel it, right?
Yeah, it's a tough one to try to give some advice like that, because you maybe not necessarily need to do that, but can you, or, you know?
Is it right for the moment?
Yeah. So we went back and forth, and we made it work, and... went into the studio, and another way that was, I've always been very prepared, like every down to every part you're playing when you go into the studio, so you're not wasting recording time.
Yeah.
You get down to business and you cut the songs and you get out of there. Yeah. But Goldstein works a different way, and I'll be honest, I was a little nervous about it because we brought in some session players, Anna Ruddick and Derek Downham. Anna plays with Randy Bachman and a ton of artists, and they really did not know the songs going into the session, where if I was a session player, I'd be freaking out, man. Yeah. Like, God, I got to know the stuff.
These people are at a whole nother level.
Yeah, and
right?
he's like, trust me, man, these are some serious players. It's going to bring it to another level, and it absolutely did. And that's one of the...
And that to be a lesson to you. If you're a young songwriter and you're going to put some money aside and hire, like, the best, because, my God, you know, when you
some
sit
magic
down...
Happened,
and it comes out, like, naturally and quick. If you don't have the tape rolling on the first take, you miss the best one.
That's right.
When other people are lifting songs, trying to figure out the progression, those people are playing magic.
Yeah.
All right. So the first one we're going to hear is Steering With My Knees, and we've all done that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Smearing an oiler or, like, you know, getting a Hummer or something.
Yeah, I wrote this song, Steering With My Knees. I was driving home from work, and
roiling.
I had the melody in my head, so I grabbed my phone with steered with my knees, grabbed my phone, voice notes.
When the bug hits, you gotta write it down, because you know it's so fleeting,
right?
Yeah,
it could be gone as soon as I turn the corner, you know, something happened. So I did that, put it down, worked on it. I wrote the song about basically that drive home from work, with the things that were there surrounding me, and the idea of I was physically driving with my knees, and the idea of, you know, metaphorically driving with my knees through this, you know, life, for instance.
I get it, but I'm a freak. But you don't have to be, because you get it right here, condensed, beautiful, on barbershoppodcast.com.
Sun's in my eyes, cutting through that brilliant sky. There ain't no guarantee that I can see the lights waiting up that concrete mile. Well, I'm steering with my knees. The sun's sinking low, dropping in that dark blue sky. I still got somewhere else to go.
Great, big, beautiful, small world here out of Hamilton, Ontario. Barbershop Podcast. That is Jay Pollmann, Steering With My Knees. A sneak peek off his upcoming record. Is it going to be an EP or is it going to be an LP?
EP.
That's what people are doing these days because your attention span is getting smaller, and that's why we're requiring you to suck it up for like an hour to find out who they are and why you care. I want to give a shout out to our great sponsor, and speaking about small world, HamiltonArtist.ca have been with us for so long because they are artistic people. They print anything on anything. That is to say, if you have a logo, a message, or anything that you want exposed to the greater world, you're going to want HamiltonArtist.ca to do it. They have a brand new location, and that location is where I worked. I worked for the biggest multinational market research firm in the world, AC Nielsen. And I got married and I had lots of money, and then kind of things went a bit haywire. And I was married and I started selling insurance at 627 Main Street East, right by Big Brothers Hamilton, very close to where the studio is right now. And Hamilton Artists, who've been just east of the Delta for the longest time have just moved. And I drove by because she said, oh, it's in this area. And I go, I think that's the same building. So right. HamiltonArtist.ca has their new setup in a place where I sold life insurance as a newlywed who just lost his job in quiet desperation, an artist being frittered away on the coals of cruel humanity. But now there is a life force at 627 Main Street East between Sanford and Burris. You know, if you're in Hamilton, you can go find it, pick your stuff up. I'm sure you can arrange it. But it is the real internet world now. You can get them at HamiltonArtist.ca. You want to use the old telephone, and there's a new app in the telephone where you can talk into it as a microphone. It works as a vocal communicator as well. If you want to use the telephone, it's 289-396-1653, 289-396-1653. HamiltonArtists.ca, they print anything on anything. They're committed to helping the artist, your sports team, your business, get your message across, mugs, T-shirts, anything that you can think of. Get part of the online community, get something original and unique, online member discounts. They have like candles and jewelry, T-shirts, custom wear. Again, because of the internet, you have an idea. They can make it into a reality. All we say is they love Hamilton. They love original music. They love Barbershop Podcast. We love them. Show them some love. HamiltonArtist.ca. All right. We got Jay Pollmann. That is P-O-L-L-M-A-N-N.
Double L, double N.
Infectious kind of blues. We've had a lot of blues artists, a lot of different style of blues, talked about blues being the granddaddy of modern music, about how those triads and those chords and those notes are kind of the core of everything. Mm-hmm. How did you, and a lot of like, you know, Canadian white dudes don't feel comfortable in being called blues guys because they feel that that's like I'm appropriating this.
Yeah.
Where I see it is like blues is like herpes. It's a beautiful thing that goes everywhere, right? You only get it from doing the best thing, right?
It's a beautiful thing.
It is, right? You know, that's called the kiss of love. So blues is like that where you don't get it casually, you get it intimately.
Yeah,
so talk about your brand of the blues and what it means.
My brand of blues, I'm not like your traditional blues artist, and I'm not attaining to be a blues artist. It's just kind of what is coming out, and the blues community has kind of taken notice of it a little bit, and things have been rolling a bit on that side. So the part of the thing is, we were talking social media marketing and stuff. You kind of have to market and brand yourself and say, I'm this style, I'm this genre.
It's required. So, you have to fight the urge to not brand yourself.
I know. So
right?
I came up with Foot Stomp and Rootsy Blues, and I'm going to stick with that.
That's going to be your tag, your bumper sticker. You make it, right?
I got a bit of room to work with, a little bit of wiggle room in there with my writing. So blues was always part of everything from Zeppelin to, I remember seeing B.B. King in town here, and it's everywhere. It's in everything. So I'm not necessarily, I know there's a lot of blues people who just listen to the blues too, and I don't, to be honest, I don't really sit down and listen to just the blues or, you know, specifically the blues, because it comes from everywhere, all different styles of music, so, yeah. I think a lot of artists
It's self-evident, because I really think that, especially because you're not comping stuff, you're not like, you didn't sit there and learn the riffs off the record.
Yeah.
This is what's kind of happened from your upbringing,
because
all those songs.
Because that's my favorite,
blues based,
too.
Exactly. All right, we're gonna do another live one. What are you gonna play for us next, my friend?
I'm gonna do a tune called "I'm Not Crazy, But I'm a Close Second."
Oh, I love good songwriting and I love good titling. There are people who work for newspapers whose job it is to only write the headlines. I thought that would be fantastic if I could get a gig. That would be like next to mattress tester, cookie dough taster, porn reviewer, all at once, a workaholic kind of job. I think that would be it. I think that would be it. But we've got it live, the best kind of music, right here. Jay Pollmann at BarbershopPodcast.com.
cut me some bread, babe. Then cut me some slack. I'm smoking them cigarettes to get my raspy voice to come back. Said I'm a terrible liar. You can see right through my skin as I muster up the courage to meet up with old friends. I'll get lost. I'll get lost. I'll get lost. I'll get
Jay Pollmann. How good could he be? I mean, you've never heard of him, right? Can't be any good because you've never heard of him, eh? That's the problem. You are only able to absorb what is fed you. And if the feeders are the people who are going to snap your head off and feed you to the masses, that's maybe not a good line to get in. Make sure that, like your opinion and your vote, your music is set free. Take control of your destiny and get behind the people who get behind you. And we're talking about Boxo Studio and Barbershop Podcast. You got something to be done? We can do it. We can help you with it. I keep forgetting, you know, this is so awful. because it all this stuff comes out of Boxo Studio. We don't even have a font ready. Yet if I go on some sort of like, we are so bad, just like as people promoting ourselves, right? Going around promoting other people all the time, but it's like, oh yeah, daddy's got to eat too, you know? Right. And this is a tough business to make money in because artists don't have money. And there's no mechanisms in place because music is seen as an economic driver. Music is seen as a self-sustaining, pre-existing entity that you can use to leverage your political gains and, you know, bake up some sort of fictional economic number vis-a-vis filling cabs and restaurants and hotel rooms because people want to come to Hamilton. Why? Oh, because it's a music city. That's sexy, isn't it? I want to go somewhere where it's a music city, right? So now this is an industry that the municipal government is cashing in on. And their investment in this industry is absolutely zero, right? They are there like with their basket grabbing the fruit off the tree and they're putting nothing into the soil. The arrogance of that alone sets me off. So when you think this is a music show, you're wrong. This is a political, social revolution. Fucking right.
People we don't like. Yeah.
Yeah. So you're gonna learn that in the short haul and the long haul. Comedy and music is a way to reach people.
Yeah.
Talk about.
You gotta have it.
You do. And for all you know, if you can make your bum move and you can learn a lesson at the same time, it's a great thing. And that's where you feature people who are looking to change the world 2, 3, 4, 5 degrees at a time. I don't care. But they're not sitting in complacency and judgment. They're here. They're bringing their story. They're bringing their music here. Barbershop Podcast. We're going to do another one off of... is this another one off of the upcoming EPA? You brought all the good stuff because you knew
hold
it would
back
be...
a little bit.
Because this is on the interweb forever. Head in the clouds. Haven't we all been there? This particular story has any this particular...
It's really tying into what we're talking about. It's the... Head in the clouds is I wrote this with the idea of pursuing music still, with, you know, having my head in the clouds with, you know, maybe
gotta
from
believe.
An outside perspective, but the, you know, to kind of be up in the clouds and having a reason to still do this and at the same time having, you know, my feet grounded and my roots knowing, you know, not to just, you know, think I can do this, I'm going to be, you know, number one in the charts or something. Like, it's just not how it works in the music industry. So this song's, you know, about staying grounded, but at the same time pursuing something you're passionate about.
Wonderful. The message we love to convey everywhere here, barbershoppodcast.com. Head in the Clouds, upcoming EP from Jay Pollmann. And when do you expect to drop this baby?
Maybe in the fall. My time with it, but for good reasons.
Yeah, and you're going to hear it. You're going to hear it, and then you're going to love it so much when it comes out. You pick it up on CD Baby, iTunes, Amazon, wherever. Go get it from his website. Get yourself a nice CD with a fat wave file. Yeah. Treat yourself right. Good music deserves to be listened to properly. All right, Jay Pollmann is in here. I'm going to give a quick shout-out before we go to another live tune to... you know, not that I was in any kind of tax trouble, but it's nice when you have a person who does your books for you, because, you know, if they ever come after you, it's not my fault, you know, and they never come after them because they're so good. We're talking about taxes done right, 905-529-6435. If you got a late tax return or years of undone tax returns, there is money in store for you. Get it done. Go back on the books. They'll take care of that. If you're an artist who's been dreading it and putting it off, Heather will work with you. Really good people. Multiple returns, again, no problem. Adjustments, they'll do the work for you. They're caught up on all their bookkeeping. If you are a client of Boxo Studio, or even if you've been on the podcast, all you have to do is say it, and it's kind of like the code word at the speakeasy. You're going to get yourself a deal. Jay Pollmann is in studio. He is playing his guitar. And even brought a kick drum in here to kick, to give you some of the feel and the impetus of the music he's playing. You're going to do another live one? What are you going to do for us?
Yeah, let's do a little Loose Lips Sink Ships.
Loose Lips Sink Ships. They used to say that in World War II about don't talk shit, people are listening. Right here, barbershoppodcast.com.
Thank you.
Great job, guys, in the sound booth. I got to say, when you hear this one, you're going to really like it, Jay. A performer and performance, an entertainer, okay? A singer, songwriter who's not expecting you to sit around and listen to his whiny diary. He's laying down stuff with passion and aplomb. And it is Jay Pollmann. LLN. Check him out on his link here, Barbershop Podcast. Check out Barbershop Podcast. Do us a proper. Subscribe to us. Like us. Share. Follow. We're all over the interweb. We are the podcast. You can't do this. Okay. Well, you know what? I'm just going to go, because we've been chatting so good, I'm going to go right to a tune. So I'm going to do this one here. It is the next one, Sick and Tired. We've all been sick. We've all been tired. We'll talk about it when we get back from it. It's Jay Pollmann, a sneak peek on an upcoming EP that's not going to be available to the fall, but here it is, early summer, and you're hearing it right here, right now, on barbershoppodcast.com.
I'm sick and tired of being tired, and I'm tired and sick of being sick. I said I'm done with being pushed over, till I ain't taking more of it. I see, shut your front door, close your window. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it.
Jay Pollmann, right here, Barbershop Podcast, Sick and Tired. It's an EP coming up in the fall. Do you even have a name for it yet?
The album's going to be called Head in the Clouds.
Head in the Clouds, the tune you heard, the one before that. Fantastic. Great, great record. This is an early release, an early cut, some working copy that you get to sample. Means when it comes out, you buy yourself this CD. It's going to be great. As our every live performance, I mean, 191 shows, an average of three or four, like we're talking 600, 650 live tunes out of Boxo Studio. No one shit the bed, right? That's a great thing. You want a performance, you're going to get a performance. Jay Pollmann's going to give you another one, a live tune. What are you going to do for us?
Yeah, this one's called Make the Move.
Make the Move. Got to do it right here, right now, at barbershoppodcast.com.
Change, calling out for months now, but that voice will pull me back down, bring me to my knees, said I'm done.
So I'm picking up and I'm a making. I've been spending all my time now, all the wrong places. I've been giving all my advice now, unfamiliar spaces. Black cloud will keep hanging unless you do what you're told. So I'm picking up and I'm a break the mold.
Pollmann, JAYPOLLMANN. Go check him out on your social media and support him. He's got a record coming out, including these wicked tunes captured here live at Boxo Studio. You've been woodshedding, you've been working, you've been pouring your heart and soul into these songs. You recorded them, you know them really well. Are you at that point? Because they say with a songwriter, and I know from experience, there's a great love when you give birth to something, and then there's a period of hatred and, you know, and then kind of wrestling with it until you've kind of massaged it in the corners.
Yeah.
How much do you value the communicative angst and the realism in a song as opposed to making the perfect war machine?
So it makes it real, I think, when you struggle with it a little bit. I like to hash them out, playing them live a little bit, because you get a feel, and not so much just with the audience, but what you're feeling, if it's working or if it's not. And I've always been able to kind of tell, it's like, just scrap it, or, you know, you got to rework it, or it's working.
Was it tough not to be too hard on yourself? Most critics are like, they realize it's like, I'm not my own best judge, and I'm over the fact that I'm patting myself on the back, but I'm really worried that I'm cutting my own legs sometimes.
Yeah, I do that. I don't know. I don't do it a lot where it's, I get upset or at the songs, or I need to ditch them, or I'm so frustrated, like you see in the movies where they crinkle the page and throw another one away. Like, that doesn't happen to me. I kind of, if it's working, it's not. I have riffs galore and progressions galore stacked up that I, that's part of me that feels like I'm missing out. I need to get to those and make them something, but the ones that happen happen for a reason, I think.
Yeah, me too.
In a weird way.
Me too. And it's when music is based on, like, people talking about popularity. Is McDonald's the best restaurant because they sell the most hamburgers? Like, I don't think so. And I don't think anyone even in that industry would argue that.
Yeah.
And yet, that is what's driven the industry since it became a quote-unquote industry.
Yeah.
And it was pretty relatively recent that a songwriter had any kind of sway. Usually it was somebody in a staff, a room full of writers, and it's getting churned out. Mm-hmm. But people got addicted to a bit of blood, but of heart blood.
Yeah, it comes around, doesn't it? It gets too polished, and then it comes around, and people wanted something a little bit real again.
Exactly.
But I mean, we're talking popular music, like, I don't...
But there's so many millennials that there's a huge chunk of them that know they've been fed processed plastic crap, and they are hungry. They're some of our greatest fans here at Barbershop Podcast.
They're out there.
Yeah, they don't have to make me Ryan or anyone here jump through hoops to prove anything. They buy it at face value. They know where it comes from and what's real. This is what happens every week here at Barbershop Podcast. Everyone here is a professional musician, world-class professional musician. And guess what? They're not a stranger to you anymore. If you love it, check them out. Share it, follow it, buy their material, support the kind of things, the cornerstones that make life worth living. We got one more song before we say goodbye. It's off of the CD, Head in the Clouds, the EP that's going to be coming out in the fall. It is Watering Hole. We've all been to a watering hole. Some of us just have a hard time leaving it. Is it a campy song? Does it kind of tie up? Is it a euphemism playground? What is the deal?
It was one that we had to leave because it was no longer there. So I'm from a very small town of Cayuga, about half and 40 minutes south of here.
You're from Hamilton, but now you're...
I was born in Hamilton, grew up in Cayuga. There's only two bars in town, and one of them became our watering hole. And my old band used to play there quite a bit, and we threw some amazing shows. It's the only spot to play locally other than house parties. So we made some great money doing that. That was able to help us make records and do other things. And it was a great spot, and we were really gaining some traction locally, and the place closed down. Yeah. It always happens.
This week, found out the Wellington Tavern closed its doors. Yeah, Wellington and Cannon in Hamilton, Ontario. Sorry, keep going. Mm. You're done with your story?
There's a little bit more.
Yeah, finish it. I truncated you. I'm sorry. I'm not usually like that. Go ahead.
There's a lot of details to it, but the short story is they turned it into a thrift store for a little while, which is great because the clothes are just on the pool tables and the bar in there, which is awesome for a thrift store. And that ultimately closed, and they did a couple movie shoots there recently. And now it was just in the paper the other week, the little local... hold them in paper that it's going to become the library. They're going to demolish it, and they're going to be a beautiful new library there for everybody. So it's come a long way.
Swords into plowshares, Cayuga style. This is your watering hole, barbershoppodcast.com.
Close down.
Gotta love the Watering Hole. Gotta love Barbershop Podcast. I love you, Jay Pollmann. Thanks so much for coming down.
Thanks for having me.
I love Gary Greenland. I love Ryan Cannon, my bestest kind of producer slash bandmate slash buddy slash friend. I love all of you who've come here and made Barbershop Podcast what it is today. If you want to support us, get behind us, be the kind of proponent that this world needs, and the world needs music. For all the boys and for Jay Pollmann, thanks for coming out. See you next week.